This morning I'm going to speak on a subject called rejection. There are many emotions that we encounter, negative emotions like jealousy. We are victims of jealousy or envy or hatred. You could name many, but I find that one subtle one that affects us, many people, right from childhood days, is this subject called rejection. First of all, I want to say the definition of rejection is something like this: the feeling of being unwanted, excluded, worthless, not really belonging, standing on the outside looking inside, but do not know how to get inside, get on the inside. And it's a deep-seated wound. Now, I know some of us may have had encountered many similar situations of rejection, and some of us have bounced back and are getting on with life, which is good. But there are some of us where this rejection has caused deep-rooted scars, and those deep-rooted scars linger around and manifest occasionally out of us and cause us to be disoriented. We are not what we should be, and we are in trouble all the time as a result of the whole thing. What do people do in order to handle rejection? And these are the wrong ways people handle rejection. The first and foremost way they handle rejection is by being depressed. Then there is another way people handle rejection, and that is by putting on a mask. And the third way some people handle rejection is by being very angry in their whole process. And therefore, they are filled with a desire for anger and revenge. And so, these three types of reactions, wrong reaction, whether it is depression, whether it is, this masking, or whether it is revenge or anger or bitterness or murderous thoughts, all three are not God glorifying. That's not how God wants us to handle whatever we are doing. He wants us to handle ourselves in an appropriate way. How can we handle these issues that we are facing in our life? And the only way we can do it is by coming to the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus, the second person of Trinity, made his wish into a command for himself. And it says in Philippians 2, he did not consider his throne or his status or his position to be something to grasp. But he let go of his royal robes, let go of his so-called position in heaven, and he took on the form of man. He took on the form of an ordinary man. He wore our clothes. He walked on our roads. He wore our shoes. And he came to drink of this particular cup. Recall in the Garden of Gethsemane, if you are seated here feeling all alone, Jesus says, I know how you feel. Give me your cup. Give me your cup. And I will drink of it. That's why I came. Father doesn't want you to drink of that cup of loneliness. Give it to me. I will drink and I will face the consequences of that. You don't face the consequences. That's what he says. So this is the gospel, that Jesus came to drink from our cup. But that is only half the gospel. There is another part of the gospel. And that gospel is this. If this cup originally belonged to us, there was a cup that Jesus had that was his own cup. If this cup had rejection, this cup had acceptance. You remember, Father said, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased, a cup of acceptance. If this had sickness, this had power to heal. If this had curses, this was the cup of blessings. If this was sin, then this was forgiveness. If this was death, this had life. Everything you speak of, which we associate with what was in this glass, the opposite of that was in this particular place. And what Jesus says is, not only he says, come, give me your cup, but he says, take my cup and go as you go home.